Poštovani gledaoci, dobrodošli u Granice istoka. Ja sam Harun Karčić. U ovom izdanju emisije analiziramo sve veći utjecaj Kine u Južnoj Aziji i na Bliskom istoku. Kina jača iz godine u godinu, kako u ekonomskom, tako i u diplomatskom i vojnom smislu. Pored sve većeg angažovanja u Južnoj i Jugoistočnoj Aziji, Kina je proteklih godina prisutna i u zemljama Bliskog istoka. Danas je jedan od najvećih investitora na Bliskom istoku, najveći kupac sirove nafte iz zaljeva i jedan od glavnih izvoznika oružja i vojne opreme toj regiji. Tokom nedavnog sastanka čelnika 21 arapske države u Pekingu, kineski predsjednik Xi Jinping je obećao 20 milijardi dolara u zajmovima za razne projekte ekonomske saradnje širom Bliskog istoka. Šta Kina želi postići time, analiziramo u nastavku naše emisije. Ali prije toga, pogledajmo uvodni prilog o novom putu svile koji gradi Peking.
6000 km dug put svile stoljećima je bio najvažnija ruta za povezivanje Azije i Europe. Kineska dinastija Han prije više od 2000 godina razvila je cijelu mrežu puteva za trgovinsku razmjenu, koja je povezala Kinu sa Bliskim istokom i Europom. Danas svila nije najznačajnija trgovinska jedinica, ali ruta od Kine do Europe preko Kirgistana, Tadžikistana, Pakistana, Bliskog istoka i Turske itekako je značajna. Kina se ponovo želi povezati sa Europom. Već od 2013. godine, kada je prvi put najavio inicijativu poznatu kao jedan pojas, jedan put, kineski predsjednik Xi Jinping i njegova administracija aktivno rade na promociji i realizaciji tog projekta, vrijednog više od 1 trilijuna dolara. Kineska inicijativa realizovat će se kroz dva dijela. Prvi je vezan za razvoj infrastrukture u kopnenim predjelima država partnera, sve do Europe, uključujući ogromnu mrežu pruga, energetskih cjevovoda i autoputeva. Drugi dio odnosi se na razvoj pomorskih ruta u Indijskom okeanu i Perzijskom zaljevu. Jačanje političke i vojne moći, siguran pristup energetskim izvorima, jačanje domaće valute i trgovinski rast samo su neki od motiva za realizaciju tog megaprojekta, koji se već naziva novim putem svile. Investirajući u infrastrukturu izvan svoje države, kinesko rukovodstvo se nada većem profitu od ogromnih vanjsko-trgovinskih rezervi, koje Kina posjeduje, ali i ostvarivanju sigurnosti u njenom susjedstvu. Međutim, nije Kina jedina zainteresovana za svoje susjedstvo. Još 2011. godine Sjedinjene Američke Države predstavile su viziju ekonomske infrastrukture integracije Centralne Azije, nadajući se osiguranju političke stabilnosti i značajnijeg prisustva u regiji nakon napuštanja Afganistana. Preostaje vidjeti koliko će se ruske ambicije u regiji Centralne Azije razlikovati od američkih i kineskih. Rusija se takmiči sa Kinom za dominaciju u regiji i krenula je sa vlastitom regionalnom integracijom u sklopu Euroazijske ekonomske unije, ali i značajnim direktnim investicijama u Turkmenistanu, Uzbekistanu i Kazahstanu, državama koje su dio kineske inicijative. Ukoliko se inicijativa Jedan put, jedan pojas uspješno realizuje, uprkos američkim i ruskim interesima, veliki dio svjetske ekonomije bit će preusmjeren ka Kini. Emil Sučeska, Al Jazeera.
Kina ima jednu od najbrže rastućih ekonomija svijeta, a taj novac koristi da ojača svoju vojsku i utjecaj u svijetu. Pogledajmo i neke statističke podatke. Idemo sada do Islamabada gdje se nalazi Manzoor Khan Afridi, profesor međunarodnih odnosa i stručnjak za Kinu. Professor Manzoor, hello and welcome to Al Jazeera. Now, how would you describe Chinese foreign policy over the last couple of years with the development of the economy and the military? Do you think China will conduct a more aggressive and assertive foreign policy or will be more focused on trade and cooperation?
Well, the Chinese foreign policy, especially if you look in the last 4 or 5 years or maximum in the last since last decade, it is developing in a new way, and I think it's the continuation of the Deng Xiaoping policy when he opened China up to the rest of the world and there was modernization and reforms program. I think China has what introduced the good liberalist policy in the Deng Xiaoping period. So now the current president of China, Mr. Xi Jinping, he is refocusing that policy in the shape of China dream, and he is also stressing for the people-to-people contact in the China's good neighborliness policy. So in this sense, we can see that China is now focusing especially on the economic prosperity and in the on the regional connectivity. And for this purpose, the China's BRI, Belt and Road Initiative Program, and all the extensions of it, also the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, it is just explaining the China's behavior to the rest of the world, and especially to the neighboring states. And China want to secure its borders for the economic prosperity. China want to have outreach, especially in regional organizations. That is why it is one of the active player and founding members of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. And China want to secure first its neighborhood and to win the confidence of its neighbors around all the frontiers of China. So I think that China in the short run will not have very aggressive policy. China doesn't want to have tussle with any great power or United States.
Chinese President Xi Jinping recently stated, and I quote, China wants to become the keeper of peace and stability in the Middle East, unquote. Does China really want to be a peacekeeper or does it want to secure resources for itself in the Middle East?
If you look to the China's Middle East engagement, I think it's more focused on the energy security and on the economic cooperation. China doesn't want to be that kind of to have leading power or the leading role in Middle East what the United States has experienced or what Russia has. China want to have energy security for this purpose, especially Saudi Arabia, Iran and Iraq. These are the three states where China is too much involved. And if we see, so in the last couple of days, China has announced some $20 billion loan to the Middle Eastern countries and also some $116 million aid to the Middle Eastern countries, out of which around $15 million aid would be given to Palestinian refugees and to the Palestinian people. So I think that China has no that historical religious baggage and the sectarian divide in Middle East. China has not been involved, and historically speaking, China has not that colonial legacy in Middle East. That is why it is respected in Middle East, and China doesn't want to take any side. That's why China want to have balanced approach and balanced relation on the one hand with Iran and Saudi Arabia, on the other hand with Palestine and the Israel. China has very good trade relationship with Israel, and China has also reiterated its stance on the Palestinian issue, especially if you see in the December 2017 when there was a move from United States to declare Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. So it was China who said that East Jerusalem must be the capital of Palestine, and the Palestine state should be declared as that was before the 1967 Arab-Israel war. So by all this discussion, I mean that China is more focused on regional integration, people-to-people contact and energy security, and not that gatekeeper and peacekeeper in Middle East.
Right. Now, the Chinese military base in Djibouti in Eastern Africa, which is part of the One Belt, One Road initiative, is considered to be the first step towards a large network of bases across the Indian Ocean. Is such a mega project too big a bite to chew for China?
Well, it is a really important question, and many analysts are of the opinion that China will have a threatening position in near future, because for the first time China has opened its first military base in Djibouti, which is strategically important in the Horn of Africa, and that is also closely associated with the Indian Ocean. China will have more military bases, and that is why policymakers and the analysts, especially in the Western world and United States, they are focusing and they are terming the seaports building of China in the Southeast Asia and South Asia, also in some other countries and Indian Ocean, that it is the string of pearls. But officially China is denouncing it, and China said that it is for the peaceful purpose and it is against the maritime piracy and to secure its energy security, and the Djibouti military base, that is for the logistical support for the Chinese military, which is over there in Africa, and that is also for the peacekeeping operations to help them in Africa. So I don't think so that in the near future China will have that kind of provocateur, assertive policy against the United States or any great power. I think that China, what has developed its first military base in Djibouti in the last year in 2017, it is against the piracy and it is for the logistical support, in my opinion.
Right. Now, relations between China and Pakistan are considered to be very strong. The China-Pakistan economic corridor is under construction, will be finished soon. Military and economic relations are at a very high level. How does Pakistan perceive a greater Chinese presence in South Asia?
Well, China has very close cooperation with South Asia, and in this South Asia, Pakistan is the biggest friend of China, and you know, the sweeter than the honey and higher than Himalayas. It is very famous quotation about Pakistan-China friendship. So a stronger China, that is in favor of Pakistan, because we have seen a stronger United States, stronger Soviet Union and Russia, but we had ups and downs in relations with them. It is only China that China has not threatened Pakistan since the starting of Pakistan-China friendship. Why we see a stronger China that can be an for advantage for Pakistan? Because Pakistan and China, they are members in Shanghai Cooperation Organization, and it was China which lobbied for Pakistan membership in SCO. Also, China, it is an observer state in the SAARC, South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation, where Pakistan is supporting it. Also, Pakistan is playing a bridge role between OIC and China. Pakistan and China, both of them, they are members in APEC, Asian Pacific Economic Cooperation Forum. And also, Pakistan and China, they are members in the KECA Conference on Interaction on Confidence Building Measures in Asia. China has ASEAN Plus 3 engagement with the Southeast Asian nations, where Pakistan is a member in the ARF ASEAN Regional Forum. So all this means that China, a stronger China, that's in favor of Pakistan, and Pakistan is not against of the stronger Chinese position.
Right, Professor Manzoor, it was a pleasure speaking to you. Thank you. Thank you so much for your time.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Poštovani gledalci, bio je to Manzoor Khan Afridi, profesor međunarodnih odnosa iz Islamabada. A prvi kontakti Kine sa zemljama Bliskog istoka vežu se za dinastiju Han još prije gotovo 2000 godina. U vrijeme hladnog rata, Egipat je 1956. godine postao prva arapska država sa uspostavljenim diplomatskim odnosima sa Kinom. Kraj hladnog rata, ali i zaljevski ratovi, drastično su promijenili balans snaga na Bliskom istoku i otvorili vrata snažnijem kineskom prisustvu. Odnosi Kine i bliskoistočnih zemalja danas sve su srdačniji. Širok je spektar kineskih interesa koji se mogu podijeliti u tri kategorije: nafta, trgovina i investicije i sigurnost. Godine 2015. Kina je nadmašila SAD kao najvećeg uvoznika sirove nafte na svijetu. Svakog dana Kina uveze 6,2 milijuna barela sirove nafte, 60% iz zemalja Bliskog istoka. Poređenja radi, Saudijska Arabija izvozi više nafte Kini nego Americi. a Međunarodna agencija za energiju procjenjuje da će se količina uvezene nafte sa Bliskog istoka udvostručiti do 2035. godine. Nafta će uskoro biti prevožena iz pakistanske luke Gwadar do kineskog grada Kashgar naftovodom dugim 3000 km. Tako će biti skraćen put bliskoistočne nafte za najmanje 10.000 km. Kina je zemljama Bliskog istoka trgovinski partner broj 1. Od 2004. do 2014. godine trgovina između Kine i zemalja Bliskog istoka povećana je za nevjerovatnih 600%. Najveći trgovinski partneri Kine na Bliskom istoku su Saudijska Arabija, Ujedinjeni Arapski Emirati i Iran. Trgovina Kine i Saudijske Arabije iznosi 70 milijardi dolara, sa Emiratima 46 milijardi, a sa Iranom 31 milijardu. Kina izvozi ogroman asortiman proizvoda, od plastike preko građevinskog materijala do vojnih dronova. 60% kineske trgovine odvija se Suetskim kanalom, stoga je Kina investirala više od milijardu dolara za razvoj luka i pristaništa za istovar svoje robe u Egiptu. U narednih 10 godina Kina planira povećati bilateralnu trgovinu sa arapskim zemljama sa 240 milijardi dolara godišnje na 600 milijardi dolara. Kina je trenutno najveći investitor na Bliskom istoku sa ulaganjima vrijednim 29,5 milijardi dolara. Po pitanju vojne saradnje između 2007. i 2011. i 2012. i 2016. godine, Kina je povećala izvoz oružja vlastite proizvodnje za 74%. To znači da je ta zemlja danas treći veliki izvoznik oružja nakon SAD-a i Rusije. Prethodnih decenija Kina je prodavala većinu oružja Pakistanu, Bangladešu i Mijanmaru. Danas izvozi oružje u više od 55 zemalja svijeta, među kojima su i brojne američke saveznice. Primjera radi, Kina trenutno gradi fabriku vojnih dronova u Saudijskoj Arabiji u okviru zajedničkog projekta vrijednog 65 milijardi dolara. Na Bliskom istoku je velika potražnja za kineskim raketama, jurišnim puškama i bespilotnim letjelicama. Kina je otvorila i prvu vojnu bazu u inozemstvu, u Džibutiju, vrijednu 600 milijuna dolara, odakle kineska mornarica osigurava kineske teretne brodove od piratskih napada. Indonezija je jedna od najmnogoljudnijih zemalja Azije, koja u proteklim godinama razvija sve prisnije odnose sa Kinom. Detaljnije o odnosima Džakarte i Pekinga pojašnjava nam Hasan Wirayuda, bivši ministar vanjskih poslova Indonezije.
Mr. Wirayuda, once again hello and welcome to Al Jazeera Balkans. Now, relations between China and Indonesia since 1965 have been rocky, to say the least. There was the communist-led insurgency in the 1960s and 70s. There was a complete severing of ties, of diplomatic ties between China and Indonesia in 1967. Then there were the attacks on the ethnic Chinese minority in Indonesia in 1998. However, recently, China and Indonesia inked a huge contract worth $23 billion as part of China's One Belt, One Road initiative. Just how complicated are Indonesia's relations with Beijing, and why do the two countries need each other?
Well, yes, we had that part of our history. The communist coup d'etat in 1965. China, to many of us, was seen as, implicated in that part. That's why we severe our diplomatic relations, but we renew our relations by 1990. Yes, we had the incidents of 1998 at the time of huge transition in Indonesia from a military-dominated regime to a democracy. That's why a process of reform initiated in 1999. So when you refer to the 1998 incidents against some Indonesian ethnic Chinese, it was an aberration rather than the rules. You know? But you miss the fact that in the beginning of reform, we corrected our systems. We introduced respect of human rights as our main policy, including, of course, non-discriminatory policy against anyone, but also that during the time of President Wahid, that was between 2001-2003, new law on human rights was promulgated, but also Confucianism was for the first time recognized as one of the six recognized religions in Indonesia. And President Wahid also allowed a Chinese group to express their culture and traditions openly, like many other ethnic groups in Indonesia.
Now, does Indonesia share suspicion with other Southeast European countries when it comes to China's ever more assertive foreign policy?
Well, actually, since 2004, from Indonesian perspective, while China claimed that they enjoy peaceful rights, to me at least, then as foreign minister, I saw that when a country holds both economic power, China was then number two, now it's becoming number one, and with so much money they may build their military, and that's the fact. As saying that we cannot rely on goodwill of others. That's why we see that by 2015, China, which was readily flexed its muscle in dealing with the South China Sea tensions or conflict. But more than just questioning about the intentions of China, I think we design a better architecture of regional cooperation. In the process of community building in East Asia, Indonesia was initially alone. When we champion a more balanced and inclusive East Asia, East Asia is no longer defined as geographically Northeast and Southeast Asia, but also to include India, which by definition is South Asia, but also Australia and New Zealand. That's why East Asia Summit, which since 2005, at its first summit in Kuala Lumpur, participated by 16 countries rather than 13, meaning ASEAN plus three, China, Japan, and Korea, which some of us advocated.
Now, Indonesia was a co-founder of the Non-Aligned Movement back in the 1960s, and the non-alignment still plays a major role in Indonesia's foreign policy. However, when it comes to the South China Sea, will Indonesia help the United States maintain its regional military dominance versus China in return for U.S. support for more for the defense of Jakarta's own maritime interests?
Well, yes, Indonesia has been very consistent in its what we call active and independent foreign policy, which is in a way very much characterized by the non-aligned movement since Bandung 1955. But we don't have a direct dispute with China, actually. We are not claimants, as some of us in Southeast Asia have, like Malaysia, Brunei, Philippines, and Vietnam. Yes, there were possible overlaps of our claim to Indonesian exclusive economic zone, which is purely based on the UN Law of the Sea Conventions of 1982. The overlap was possible because China claimed a vast expanse of water in the South China Sea, some 90% of them, based on what on the notion of historical claims, but to us and to many countries in the regions, it is not based on the internationally recognized norms under the Law of the Sea Convention, in which China also actually is party. But have been actively trying to remove tensions, to promote peaceful conflict resolution. Among others, it was in 2002 that China and ASEAN agreed on what is called the ASEAN-China declaration on conduct of parties in the South China Sea. But since 2011, China and ASEAN agreed to begin the negotiations on the code of conduct on the South China Sea. Meaning, yes, there was tension, but at the same time, we are both ASEAN and China are actively trying to develop rules in which both of us subscribes.
Right, Mr. Viroyuda, it was a pleasure speaking to you. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much.
Očigledno je da Kina koristi trenutnu nestabilnost i blago povlačenje Sjedinjenih Američkih Država sa Bliskog Istoka kako bi utvrdila vlastito prisustvo u toj regiji. Inkluzivni pristup Pekinga svim ključnim akterima te regije, Saudijskoj Arabiji, Iranu i Izraelu, omogućuje Kini da se postavi kao nezaobilazan faktor u donošenju brojnih strateških odluka danas i da sebi osigura sigurno prisustvo i utjecaj u budućnosti. Bilo je to sve u ovom izdanju emisije Granice Istoka. Cijelu emisiju možete pogledati na našoj web stranici balkans.aljazeera.net. Hvala na pažnji.